we pray, and God has heard you. He has heard you. Amen. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, won't you turn with me to the book of Romans? Turn with me to the book of Romans. I want to give a disclaimer right now on the front end of this message. I was doing some praying. I was doing some traveling on last week, and over the last several weeks, I've been doing some praying and thinking about some things concerning our church and faith, and just not my walk with God, but as a pastor, thinking about this congregation's walk with God. And Lord was dealing with me about this matter concerning baptism. And I was wrestling with the fact that, God, I just wonder, does our congregation have a healthy, a spiritual understanding of baptism? Where are we spiritually, God? We've been talking about being unleashed. And unleashed has to do with being completely free. And being free to serve God with greater intensity, free to love Him, free to experiencing Him in ways we never could have imagined. And now I'm at this fundamental place of baptism where I want us to be free to experience it for what it really is and represents. I'm going to do things somewhat backwards, is that I'm going to, right now, I'm going to offer everyone in this room the privilege and the blessing of a genuine believer's baptism. That regardless of whatever your history or experience has been with baptism, my prayer will be that if for some reason there's anyone present and they can say that when I was baptized, I didn't know what it stood for, why I was doing it, didn't quite understand. But my prayer is that after today's sermon, you can say, now I know why. And not only that, I'm going to say that on next Sunday, when we have baptism, that you can do it all over again. Amen. That if there be anybody, and so that will be open and available for anyone, not just individuals who may accept for the very first time on today. But I just believe that this is an opportunity, a special opportunity for us to re-engage and reconnect with God. Amen. Look with me in Romans chapter 6, beginning with verse number 1. It says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. So I just want to talk for a few minutes about the glory of baptism. The glory of baptism. Some of you all may remember this. On the 22nd of August in 1980, a sister by the name of Diana Ross released a song called I'm Coming Out. Ring a bell for any of you? Mm-hmm. I figured it would. I'm Coming Out. The song was a hit, peaking at number 5. Pop singles charts. It was inspired by the writer. He writes it. He was inspired by three drag queens dressed like Diana Ross entering into a New York nightclub. But Diana Ross was also inspired by the lyrics because she was leaving Motown Records and coming out from under Berry Gordy's thumb. It was her coming out. The song has since been adopted to signify one's metamorphosis, someone's liberation. Anytime somebody feels that they are being released, there's a change in their lives. They are different. They are better. They are bolder. They're grander. They talk about, I'm coming out. I want the world to know. Gonna let it show. I'm coming out. That's what she said, ain't it? I thought so. That's what she said. I would sing it, but not that kind of party. And so she wants the world to know she's coming out. And when we go through baptism in essence is our bold and grand statement to the world that there has been this significant change in my life. It is the believers coming out. And therefore, what has happened is that we have allowed some other stuff to overshadow the real essence of baptism. Baptism is not the means to some kind of end. In other words, for those of us who were baptized as children, growing up in the traditional Baptist church, and some of you may can remember this, you don't get baptized so that you can sing in the sunshine choir. You don't get baptized so that you can be in the youth usher board or that you can be in the youth ministry. You don't get baptized so that you can do something. Baptism is not some type of initiation rite or ritual so that you can be a part of some special kind of club. We have used baptism, some people, you know, if there are other denominations that believe that baptism is the matter that authenticates one's salvation. That there are denominations that teach that one is not saved unless they get baptized. Well, the scriptures don't say that I am saved by baptism. I am saved through my faith in Jesus Christ. And as evidence of that faith, I then become baptized. That my first step of obedience after accepting Christ as Savior and Lord is to be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So that when we said yes to Jesus, the next thing we said then is that we get baptized. And we do so immediately. We do so as soon as possible, as soon as the opportunity presents itself. We get baptized just as Philip is engaging the Ethiopian eunuch. And the eunuch is riding, and there on the side of the road, he says, there's water. Let's make it happen right now. That he then becomes baptized. Paul here in this book of Romans, as he's writing this letter to these Hebrews, and he's helping them understand that Jewish faith and practice and heritage is inferior to the life and the law, the life that is governed by the Spirit of God. Helping them understand now that we get draw these fundamental truths about baptism just out of these few verses from the book of Romans. This is not the only place that speaks of baptism, but this is the place that I will use to help us have a solid understanding of baptism. That I want, if anything else, consider this to be a robust Sunday school lesson on baptism. That when we walk out of these doors, we walk out of these doors understanding if we were baptized, reinforcing why we got baptized. Or we walk out of here now having such a solid understanding of baptism that I'm going to be baptized on next Sunday. And I'm going to be baptized on next Sunday for the right reasons, with the right understanding, and not because grandmama scared me to death, not because somebody else told me I had to, and not because I saw other people doing it and thought, huh, that'd be kind of cool. I want to do it too. Amen? First thing we need to understand is that death no longer has dominion over us. Death no longer has dominion. Paul raises a question here. He says, shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? Because just prior to chapter 6, Paul has this great argument about the ministry of grace in our lives. But he goes on to say that by no means we died to sin. In other words, he said we died to sin. He's speaking of a condition that we once had. Before Christ, death was our destiny. That was our condition without Christ. That our lives were governed by sin. That sin ruled our lives. That on our best day, when we were firing on all cylinders, the very best thing that we could do was choose death for ourselves through our sinful practices. We were born into sin and shaped in iniquity. And so therefore, we were destined for nothing but death. As cute and cuddly as you were, as curly as your hair is, and as stout, strong, and tall as you were, if you did not have the blood of Jesus Christ covering your life, you were dead in your sins. You may have looked healthy, you may have eaten good, you may have driven right, you may have walked tall, you may have never been inside of a hospital room, never been in the doctor's office, not taken any medication, but without Jesus Christ, you were dead. And therefore, death separates. Death to sin removes the believer from the control of sin. That's what Paul says, that we are dead to sin. When we are dead to sin, that means then that sin no longer rules our lives. Now that we are in Christ, we have been freed from the trappings and the control of sin. Now that I am in Jesus Christ, sin no longer is the dark cloud over my life, and sin no longer controls me. And it doesn't mean that I stop sinning, because ain't none of you in here perfect. Myself included. I don't want us to start getting so puffed up, like, ooh, I'm in Christ, I don't sin no more. Because you just sinned right then. You did. You did. But see, when you die to sin, it removes the believer from the control of sin. We don't stop sinning, but we do not obey the cravings of sin. In other words, when the cravings of sin controls your every move, therefore then you are alive to sin. When sin pulls your strings and pushes your buttons, when sin takes you down that dark road, and when sin has you locked in a pattern of behavior, you are alive to it. But Paul says that we are dead to sin. And when we are dead to sin, now we have the ability to resist. We have the ability to not obey the cravings of sin. Don't think for one minute that because you saved, you will no longer have trouble. Don't fall for that. Don't fall for that. If not anything, if when you get saved, you're going to have even more trouble. Because there was some stuff you were doing, it didn't even cross your mind. You didn't even think about it. But then when you started living a life governed by the Spirit, you started realizing there was some stuff that you really liked and enjoyed that it was not what God desired for you. And that stuff is hard to let go. Death no longer has dominion. But then here's the thing, though. In baptism, point number two, in baptism, we die with Christ. That's what baptism is. Baptism is a metaphor, and it represents, or we identify with, something that happens in the life of Christ. When we are baptized, we are connecting and identifying with the death of Jesus Christ. You all know the story. Jesus died for our sins, right? He died for our sins, and in his death, we connect and identify with dying to sin. Jesus dies for sin, and by us identifying with his death, we die to sin. Jesus dies for sin, and Jesus, in dying for sin, he dies in our place. Because we were supposed to die for our sins. We were supposed to die for the things that break the heart of God. When we transgress the law of God and the heart of God and the will of God, we are supposed to die. The only thing that satisfies God's justice for sin is death. But God makes provision in that he loves us so much that he does not allow us to die for our sin. Jesus dies for our sin. And in the death of Jesus, I now die to sin. That Jesus releases me from the power of sin over my life. That it doesn't mean that I don't stumble. But before Christ, when I stumbled, it trapped me and kept me down. But when Jesus died for me, I may stumble, but I can get back up. There's a big difference. That I may get caught up sometimes, but because of the blood of Jesus Christ, I got a way out. And so I identify with his death. Because you see, in his atonement, Christ died and he was indeed buried. He dies a physical death, and we'll talk more about that in the coming weeks. He hangs on a cross and his heart stops beating. And the brain activity ceases and there's no more life in his body. And Joseph of Arimathea comes and takes his body and places him in his own tomb. He is buried, and burial certifies the reality of death. Anything that is dead gets buried. And if something gets buried, there's no question about it. Yep, he gone. When you bury it, you don't expect it to come back. When you bury it, you realize that there is no longer any life there and there's no use for it. Baptism is the ritual act that portrays this burial. In baptism, when you are baptized, you are signifying, you are declaring that there has been a death in my life. When I am baptized, somebody dies. It is my old self. Tell it goodbye. This is my statement to the world that the old self that you know, that you knew about me, the stuff that you knew about me, the stuff that you held against me, the stuff that I held against myself, the stuff that I allowed to define me, it is now going away. It is dying. When I am being baptized, I am now putting to death all of the stuff that held me back and that kept me from being all that God wanted me to be. In fact, when you get baptized, you ought to invite everybody that ever had anything bad to say about you. You ought to invite all the people who told all the lies about you, or all the people who told all of your business. You ought to invite everybody who ever had anything bad to say about you. You ought to invite all the folk to let them know that person who you used to dog, who you used to run down, that person who you used to talk about, that person who you used to overcome, that person is about to die and he's going down beneath the flood. That's what baptism is. That when I'm being baptized, there is a part of me that is dying and going away. And when it goes away, it is never to come back again. Now the question is, well, why you still do some of the same stuff you... The Lord is working on me, okay? We still struggling with it. But in baptism, it is the fact that we are connecting and identifying with the life of Jesus Christ. And Jesus died for my sin in my place. And what he told me to do, he told me then, therefore, that when I accept him as my Savior and Lord, he wants me now to identify with him. He says that if you're going to accept the fact that I died in your place, then you need to have some death of your own. Go down beneath the flood. That's why when we baptize by immersion. We don't sprinkle because they didn't sprinkle dirt on the dead body of Jesus. We don't sprinkle because when Jesus died, he was placed beneath the earth in a tomb and covered up. And so when we're baptized, we go down completely beneath the water, all the way down, because we are connecting with the fact that he was buried and our old sinful self is now buried as well. That person before Jesus Christ is now gone. What we're saying. That in fact, when I come back up out of this water, my nose gonna look the same way it did before I went in. My hair gonna be even kinkier when I come back up because I got it wet. I'm gonna look like the same person, but when God sees me, he won't see me like that old person anymore. And that's the last point of this message. In the glory of baptism then, that yes, we die with Christ, but also in baptism, we live with Christ. And so death and burial are not the end of the story. You all know how this thing goes, that on Friday night, Jesus died. And he stayed dead all Friday night. And he was dead all Saturday morning. And he was dead all Saturday afternoon. And he stayed dead all Saturday night. And he was dead all into the late hours of Saturday night. But early Sunday morning, Jesus got up from the grave with all power in his hands. That means then that Jesus, and in fact, when he got up, he got up alive. He didn't crawl out of the grave. He walked out of the grave. When he got out of the grave, he was alive and well with all power in his hands. So then when I get baptized, you are telling that old self goodbye. And you might be thinking, yeah, we finally done with him as I go down beneath the flood. But when they bring me back up, I'm identifying with the risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And now I'm walking with a new lease on life. In God's redemptive plan, burial is followed by resurrection. And so as Christ was raised from the dead, so also are we raised to an entirely new way of living. Yeah, you're going to come up and you're going to still look the same. But I promise you, everything is different. That when we are baptized, we are identifying with something that God is doing inside of us. Baptism becomes an external expression of an internal reality. And so therefore, when I come back up, I'm telling the world, hey world, I'm brand new. I'm made over again. Because the Bible says that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. And so when in baptism, when you see me come back up out of that water, the rest of my life begins. I start out as a new person. That's what it means to be born again. People think that, well, that's just crazy. Nicodemus thought it was crazy. Nicodemus said, how can an old man be born again? Should he go back into his mother's womb? And Jesus says, no, now you need to be born of the Spirit. That you will go down beneath the waters. And that old self, that old part of you will die. But when you come back up, you will be a brand new person. And as a brand new person, your life now is governed by the Spirit of God. As a brand new person, baptism opens your life up to new possibilities. There are new things for God. There are new opportunities for you. And so stop living your life based on your old self. Stop making choices based on your old self. And stop living based on what old folks say about you. Because the old stuff that people bring up about you, that is not who you are anymore. Now you ought to start living your life based on the new stuff about you. And the new stuff says stuff like that you can do all things in Christ who gives you strength. This book says that you are now a vessel of value. This book says some other stuff about you. This book says that you are saved. This book says that God loves you. This book says that you are more than a conqueror. This book says that you are forgiven. This book says that you have destiny. This book says that you have power. This book says that you are more than what they think you are. This book says that you can have more than what you say you can have. This book says that you are God's child. This book says what you are worth. And therefore, when I come back up out of the water, I'm a brand new person. So I'm like Diana Ross. I'm coming out. And I want the world to know. And I'm going to let it show. I may have scars from back in the day, but the Lord still sees me as his child. I may have some wounds from back in the day, but the Lord knows I'm a brand new person. And if God knows I'm brand new, I got to live brand new. I got to talk brand new. I got to walk brand new. I used to cuss you out, but now I got to bless you. I used to talk bad about you, but now I got to speak into your life. I used to let you walk all over me, but now I got to stand up and tell you, no, you can't talk to me that way. I used to steal from you, but now I want to give to you. I used to get over on everybody, but now I want to serve the world and let the world know that Christ and a life really does make a difference, because I've come out of this thing. I've come out of my backbiting. I've come out of my lying. I've come out of my stealing. I've come out of my addiction. I've come out of my divorce. I've come out of every painful experience for the better, because I have now chosen Christ as my Savior and my Lord. You see, apart from Christ, we are dead in our sins. But in resurrection, we are alive in Christ. And this new life in Christ, it really does give us new possibilities. It's all because of him that I can think differently about my life. It's all because of him that we ought to think differently as a congregation. It's all because of him that we ought to desire more for ourselves. We ought to strive for more for ourselves. We ought to be more than what we are because of him. Yes. Did he die that we may wallow in mediocrity? Did he die that we may still live tired lives? Or did he die that we may be released from the grave? Some of us, we have made grave clothes fashionable. We have made mediocrity be a matter of style. We have made the status quo be the accepted. And we've made excellence, we've ostracized it. How dare you try to live above me? How dare you try to live like you are better than stuff like cohabitation? Better than substandard living? How dare you act like you are better than me, and so you want to do this rather than do what we're already doing? But when we're baptized, I'm telling the world something. I'm making a statement. And guess what? Don't be afraid. Don't be intimidated by making this statement to say that when I say this, that means that I got to be perfect from here on out. No. Don't believe that lie, because you ain't going to be perfect. It's not going to happen. The point, though, is that you're still identifying with the work that God is doing in your life. As you come out, you're going to trip along the way. And they're going to love to see you fall. But that's all right. Just get back up. Just keep coming out. Keep coming out. That old self gonna stick every now and then, you know, even though that old part of you is dead, every now and then he tries to come back around. Every now and then he tries to break out. Every now and then, you know, sometimes we keep him on life support. Like a Frankenstein experiment. But still, it doesn't change the fact that you're made over again. You're brand new. That's why I get excited about baptism. No matter the age, but you know, we get excited, especially we clap harder for grown folk than we do for children. Doesn't matter though, it's still the same thing. Still the same thing, that when we are baptized, I'm saying goodbye to the old self. I'm saying goodbye to all the old stuff. And when I come back up, I'm saying hello to brand new. Hello to new life, new living, new experiences, new opportunities, new challenges, new relationships, greater glory, a bigger God, grander experience, greater service, greater sacrifice. But I'm coming out. Amen. Amen. Let's thank God today for his word. It's baptism, when we baptize, it is a celebration. It ought to be a celebration. Don't let it just be a matter of formality to get recorded in the family Bible. But it ought to be, this is your story. This is your declaration. When I ask the counselors to stand with me, I want to offer individuals the opportunity to respond to the appeal. And the appeal is that choose Christ for your life and start a new life. When you start this new life, you can tell everyone, you can put the world on notice, I'm starting over again. I'm walking differently because now I'm covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. You're telling everyone, I'm starting over again. I know I made mistakes before, but there's something different this time. Don't make promises. Don't say, I'm never going to make a mistake again. Don't say that. Just say the truth. It's different now because I've got the blood of Jesus. It's different now because I'm in relationship with the God of heaven. It's different now because that old self, that old person is gone. I buried him. I put him away. In fact, I want you to come and be with me next week when I get baptized. Along with me, tell the old me goodbye. And along with me, tell the new me hello. I don't know what the new me, I don't know what it stands for. I don't know what it means. I don't know where it will take me. I just believe that God's going to do something. I made a lot of mistakes in the old me. But guess what? In this new me, I got more living to do. Got more opportunities, more experiences. This appeal is for you to start a relationship with the God of heaven. Start a relationship with the God who will not hold your past against you. We've all tried to have relationships with people and tried to find people that would make us feel better, only to have our hearts broken again. In this relationship, God doesn't make you change yourself for him. God changes you for himself. In this relationship, God does not criticize you because of some choices you made. You know, I got some folk that criticize you because of the way you wear your hair. Now, some people treat you different when you make certain changes about your life. You know how they don't pay you as much attention now that you done put on a little weight. You know, you've made some mistakes and now you're just not as new and shiny anymore. In this relationship, God takes you just the way you are. Just the way you are. God takes you God doesn't tell you, go get yourself together and fix yourself up. Oh no, God takes you just as you are. And then God doesn't even tell you to start fixing yourself up. God just starts making you the way he wants you to be. He just starts, and guess what? And he don't start on the outside. God said, I like your hair just the way that it is. God said, don't change nothing about that. But God does something to your heart. And then when he starts doing something in your heart, you can't help but start looking different on the outside. Because then people start noticing, you know, you're smiling more than you did before. They start noticing you ain't changed nothing on the outside, but it's only because God is doing work on the inside of you. This is a God who will fight your battles. This is a God who will never betray you. In fact, this is a God who already purchased you, already started the relationship. He made the first step. You saying yes and you surrendering is not even the first step in the relationship. The first step was when Jesus gave his life, when he died on that cross. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. Whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God took the first step. He's just wondering now, will you accept? Will you accept what he's done for you? God died for you. That God, another way I can put it is, God wanted to be in relationship with you so bad. Bless your brother. God wanted to be in relationship with you so bad. So bad. So bad that he died. That's how bad he wanted you. He wanted to die for you. Wanted to die for you. Now let me go ahead and make this appeal, because there may be some confusion. This goes back to the original appeal before the sermon. You've heard all of this about baptism, and you remember your own baptism experience. Doesn't make you a bad person or less of a Christian, but this is an opportunity to now connect what you know with your practice. And so I want to offer this opportunity to anybody, no matter how old you are or young you are. So what if you were baptized before, but you know that when you got baptized then, you don't know what you know now? And if you would like to be baptized again, would you just stand? I want to pray for you. I want you to come this way. Just come this way. I promise you, if you consider this, some other people will consider it with you. And we can have mass baptisms, a great baptism service next week. Come on. Come on, next. Some others want to come. Don't take them out. Stay, come on. Just keep them here. Keep them here. Don't take them out. Come on. Come on. Some other people are thinking about this. This is not corny. This isn't trivial. This doesn't make you a bad person. Come on, right here at the altar, because we're going to pray. But there's some other people thinking about this. Some other people thinking about it. Right here. Just stand right here at the altar. Right here. Just come on. Come on. I want some other people need to see you, because some other people need to make this decision. Some other people need to make this decision because some people out there that are self-conscious. Oh, I'm too old to be doing that. This ain't got nothing to do with age. Come on, Brother Belton. Come on. Come on. Come on, got some other people. No, you know when you got baptized, you know you didn't know what you were doing. But today, you know. Everything you know about God. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Come on, don't worry about how people see you. So what? You've been ushering and singing in the choir and teaching Sunday school. None of that matters. What you're saying is that I know that I believe in Jesus Christ, and I know he died in my place, and I just feel like I need to make this identification and connection with him in my own life. Come on, wherever you are, because I know there's still somebody thinking about this. You're still so self-conscious, like, what does this mean about me? And what does this mean that I'm going to be getting baptized again as old as I am? But what it means is that you are taking, this is what unleashed living is all about. When I'm living unleashed, I'm making bold steps. I'm taking bold steps in my faith. I'm taking public steps in my faith. In fact, guess what? I'm coming out. I'm coming out of being a closet Christian, and I'm stepping into being a vocal and visual Christian. And I want the Lord to know, God, I identify. There's a part of me, that old self, I never really put him to rest. I never really put her to rest. But now in baptism, I'm going to undergo a real believer's baptism. And on next Sunday, we ought to fill our sanctuary with all of our relationships, all of our friends, all of our families, letting them know that, hey man, I would love if you would come next Sunday. I'm being baptized. It would mean a lot to me if you would come, because I'm making a statement. I'm identifying with the God of heaven. I'm identifying with the fact that Jesus died in my place, and I'm putting my old self to death, and I'm coming up out of the water a new person, a changed person. I've been a Christian a long time, but I just realized that this was one piece of my walk with God, one piece in my faith that was somewhat out of place, out of order. And so I'm in a season in my life where I'm putting things in their proper place. And so I'm getting baptized. God bless you, sister. God bless you. And I know there's still some people that are contemplating this decision. There's still some individuals that are contemplating this choice. And you're feeling like, you know what, I don't know what I'm going to look like when I come up wet. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. I don't know, you know, because I got, you know, we can come up with all the excuses in the world. But only you know if you know that this is something that you need to do. So what if you've been baptized before? But the point is, though, but when you were baptized the first time, did you know then what you know now? Did you know then what you know now? Back then, was it about some kind of performance? Was it a means to another end? Because really, baptism is about identification. Baptism is about explanation. And so these, my brothers and sisters, have come. They've come to make this declaration. And they're going to make this declaration to you, their church family. But then whoever else comes with them to be witnesses, they're going to make that same declaration. I'm going to ask anybody who desires, if you come with us and stand as we pray. Stand with your brothers and sisters as I pray for them. And maybe you didn't want to come down here for anybody to see you walking down the aisle. But I tell you what, though, next Sunday, you come prepared to be baptized. Come prepared next Sunday to be baptized. Whoever's here, we're going to baptize you. We'll baptize you. You'll make your statement. We're going to celebrate. This is our connection with the Christ, the first century church, the early church. This is what it means to be Christian. This element that we take all of the scriptures seriously. And so baptism is a fundamental step you take in with your walk with God. Easter is always that time when we talk about transitions and beginnings and new stuff, all of that. What better way to do so than to do so with baptism? Let's pray. God, our Father, Lord, I thank you for the courageous people before me, Lord. God, they have allowed your word to convict them, Father. They've allowed your word to inspire them. God, they have taken steps, courageous steps, God. And so, Father, I just thank you, Lord, for the work that you've done. I thank you, God, for how you have pulled on their hearts. Lord, I pray now as they're still wrestling, wondering, what does it mean? Is it real what they're doing and all of that? Father, I just trust that you're going to take care of all of that. You're going to give them assurance, God. You are brand new. You are a new man. You are a new woman. You are a new boy. You are a new girl. Lord, I don't know what this means for this congregation, but I believe, God, that you're going to do something special in this church, and you'll do it with these people. And so we thank you in advance God, I thank you for what will happen on next Sunday when we make this bold statement. I thank you, God, in advance for what, for how this will impact their families, their relationships, their co-workers, God, their friends, their peers. God, I thank you because, God, I know that there will be a ripple effect from this. God, just as your word says, you will continue to add to the family of faith daily because of saints like these. Lord, I thank you. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Sunday morning to all of our baptism candidates. Sunday morning, we'll see you. All right, for all of our baptism, the individuals who are going to be baptized again, if you'd make your way on the other side of this wall, meet with our deacons and we can get your names so that we can be properly prepared for next week. So if you are going to be in that number for baptism service on next week, if you would just go right on the other side of this wall, meet with our deacons. We just want to get your names so that we can be prepared for you on next Sunday. And even if you were not a part of the prayer, but now you realize, you know what, I need to be in that number, just make your way on the other side of this wall. Anybody, make your way on the other side of this wall. We want to get information from you so that we can be prepared, so that our celebration can be all that it should be. Amen? Amen, 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 amen. Now I got a confession to make. I didn't know what the Lord was going to do and how he was going to, you know, all of that. Now I done got kind of all confused now. Because we got to go to the table and my deacons went over there. And my deacons got to serve communion. But the Lord going to get us through it, isn't he? He's going to get us through it. He's going to get us through it. So now it's even more important. We need to make room for them.